Welcome, Toastmasters, guests throughout the room, and viewers at home. My pleasure as Sergeant-at-Arms, as Acting Sergeant-at-Arms, I should say, to welcome our President of Golden Speakers, Rick Starr.
Thank you, Will, and welcome to Golden Speakers. Fellow Toastmasters and honored guests and viewers at home, we meet every Tuesday night at 7:40 here in the club room, the meeting room at the Hy-Vee supermarket, right appropriately at the end of the ice cream aisle. So you can leave the meeting filled with bliss, go get some ice cream and be even more blissful. I'd like to welcome, I see a couple of guests sitting in the back. Could you stand, please, and tell us your name and why, what brought you to Toastmasters?
My name is Lydia.
Lydia.
I along with my friends from the Go to School Together, I came with them. So they told me it was good.
Good. Yeah. Thank you. Yes.
Yeah, my name is Akolo, and I have been, this is my fourth time here.
Ah.
Thank you.
Okay.
Also, I'd welcome our new members, Ephraim, Isaac, and Sudeep has been here for a meeting or two. Woo! After tonight's meeting, we're going to have a brief induction ceremony to officially induct you into Toastmasters. Shouldn't be more than 2 or 3 hours. And I hope you have your 20-minute speech prepared, your acceptance speech. If any of you have this, a phone, a telephone, please turn it off. We don't want the speakers interrupted during their speeches. As a reminder, for those who have roles, please bring your competent leader manual to the meeting, and you can have the role evaluated. I sound like a broken record. I say this every meeting, but it's important to do this. I'd like to read our club mission. We provide a safe, supportive and positive learning experience in which club members are empowered to develop communication and leadership skills, resulting in greater self-confidence and personal growth. And we have fun doing it. Tonight's meeting is going to be very good, very interesting, very entertaining. And to lead our meeting, I'd like to call on our Toastmaster, Mr. Art. Thank you.
Good evening, Toastmasters and guests and viewers at home. My job as the Toastmaster of tonight's meeting is to serve as the Master of Ceremonies, the MC. I'd like to introduce first the role players who are going to help run this meeting and cover the various responsibilities in the meeting. First of all, our timer tonight is Isaac Hopton Michael, new member of the club, and he is doing his job as the timer for the first time tonight, so we should give him a little bit of space as he learns his role. Isaac, would you stand and explain what you'll be doing?
My name is Isaac. Today I will be typing the speeches in the environmentals. So try to limit the speeches, the time that you have. Thank you.
There's a script in plastic there.
Do you need it?
Yeah.
Okay. Table topics are 1 to 2 minutes speeches. Should I read
this one?
The green light.
Okay. The green light is turned on at 1 minute. Okay. The second point is the yellow light is turned on at 1 minute and 30 seconds. The third point is the red light is turned on at 2 minutes and remains on until the end of the speech. Prepared speeches are usually 5 to 7 minutes. The icebreaker is 4 to 6 minutes. Some advanced level speeches are longer. The green light is turned on at 5 minutes for prepared speech, and the yellow light is turned on at 6 minutes, and we turn off the green light. The red light is turned on at 7 minutes and remains on until the end of the speech. And turn on the yellow light. For longer speech, ask the speaker how they would like to be timed. Point three, evaluations are 3 minutes. The green light is turned on at 2 minutes. The yellow light is turned on at 2 minutes and 6 seconds. The red light is turned on at 3 minutes and remains on until the end of the evaluation.
Thank you. Zach, would you please also demonstrate, let's test the lighting equipment and make sure that we're able to get the yellow, green, and red lights that
yeah.
you described.
Yeah, green light. Green light.
Very good. Thank you so much. Tonight our grammarian is Will Burns. Will, would you please explain the role of the grammarian and what you'll be doing tonight?
As grammarian, it's my job to pay a close ear to the language of the meeting. Language is the glue that binds us together, that enriches our lives, that moves us, uplifts, and depresses us. Tonight, it'll uplift us, and I'll be listening for particularly apt turns of phrase tonight. I will also provide you with the word of the day that you can use. And this is a word I don't use that much, and I'm hoping to use it as well tonight. Simpatico. It means agreeable or likable, being on the same wavelength. And an example would be that if you had, say, a dying cousin, you might say, I'm truly sorry to have lost him. He was very simpatico. And I will give a report at the end of the meeting. Thank you.
Thank you. Tonight, our awe counter is Ephraim DeWeldick. Ephraim, will you please explain your role as the awe counter?
Okay. The purpose of, I started with awe, so I got one for myself. The purpose of the eye counter is to note words and sounds used as a crutch or filler words by anyone who speaks during the meeting. I'll watch and report as and arms used during the meeting, as well as other filler words such as and, well, but, so, you know. I'll also note repeated words or phrases. So I would like everybody to be sympathetic to what I'm looking for.
Yeah.
Thank you very much. Our general evaluator tonight is Will Burns, from whom we'll hear at the later part of the meeting. And you are looking at the greeter joke master. I have some good material. So let's dive right into the prepared speeches this evening. The first of our speakers is not present. Do we have the next prepared speaker?
Santoria is the only one.
Okay. Santoria, are you? Delay. Are you ready to announce our project?
Yeah, unless you want to do table topics first or anything, but this is kind of an oddity, right? That we're missing so many speakers?
It is.
It is not.
Yeah. So I'd like to invite Jeff Shipley, her evaluator, to describe her project and introduce the next speaker.
Fellow Toastmasters, honored and distinguished guests, my name is Jeff Shipley. It's my distinct honor to invite or introduce our speaker, our first speaker, Santoria Rush, who's performing project number 2 in the Competent Communicator Manual. The purpose of the speech is to organize the speech to make it easier to understand, easier to remember, more enjoyable. We're going to set an appropriate outline which the listeners can easily follow. I'm going to tell you right now that your speaker, Santoria, has a lot of public speaking experience, and I don't want to set the expectation too hard or too high, but I really admire her speaking, and I'm really, it's an honor to introduce her today. So I, without further ado, our speaker, Santoria Rush. The title of her speech, I'm sorry, the title of speech number two is The Plight of Undead Americans and Current System of Institutionalized Racism and Media-Driven Hysteria. Please forgive me for this hasty introduction, but without further ado.
Toastmasters, honored guests, and viewers at home. Zombies, or undead Americans, is a topic that's very near and dear to my heart. It's kind of like, I'll call it a hobby, or you could call it a curse, but since I was a little girl, I've had a reoccurring zombie apocalypse dream. And because of that dream, I constantly find myself thinking about that scenario. If some of you are not familiar with the term zombie, a zombie is like a corpse or a dead person whose body is reanimated. Their skin is usually rotting. They usually have limited motor and speech capabilities. And a lot of people seem to think that they stink. So in a zombie apocalypse, the world is suddenly overrun by zombies, either by like some sort of bioengineering, a biomedical disaster, or in some cultures, a zombie apocalypse could be brought on by a bunch of pissed off witch doctors. But every time I see a zombie movie, I have a habit of going out and talking to my friends about it. What would you do if a zombie approached you? Well, many of the responses I get are very violent. Some people would stab the zombie. Some people would run the zombie over the car. Some people want to set the zombie on fire or explode the zombie. And I always ask them, why wouldn't you consider asking them for a glass of water? Or perhaps asking them if they need directions. The idea that zombies are beings that you murder whenever you come in contact with them is just a media-driven hysteria. There's no evidence to point that points to zombies being violent creatures. So to help dismiss any fear that people may have, I'd like to present three facts about zombies that will hopefully change your mind. Zombie fact number one. Zombies are good for your health. The reason that zombies are good for your health is that in neighborhoods where zombies reside, 80% of the population become active runners. Not only that, the hordes of zombies walking the streets always remind you that even if you don't feel good, you could probably get some low impact cardio in. But because of zombies' reputations, often they're turned away from charity walks, parades, Black Friday event. But who knows? Is it so odd to like to exercise a few times a week that you deserve to be decapitated? Think about that. Here's my zombie fact number two. There, zombie language is a beautiful language. Some people may consider it grunting, but really, it's a series of grunts designed to explain any emotion, thought, or phrase. So I thought it would be nice to teach you a few zombie words if you don't believe me. Okay. Gotta be really loose. This is how you say hello. It's a very easy way to say goodbye. And for really advanced zombie speakers, I'll give you this one. That means I want to move to California. My last zombie fact is that zombies make great spouses.
Ah.
And let me tell you why. A zombie spouse always shows interest. Whenever you walk into a room, they want to put their arms around you and show you how much they love you. Another reason is that zombie men never play games. They're always very direct about what they want. They never leave you guessing. Finally, zombie men appreciate what's up here. Because it's the brain that matters. And not anything else. I have another version of this joke that I will be performing at Cafe Paradiso in 2 weeks. This was the G version. Cafe Paradiso, I'll perform the more PG-13 version. So if this didn't get you to think, I would have to wonder if you were a zombie. Zombies have a beautiful heritage that they brought to us to share. When the zombie apocalypse comes, you want to be on the right side of the ethical debate. Should we be murdering zombies? Or should we be loving them? Thank you.
Thank you, Santori. Now, Isaac, if you would give us 2 minutes, if you should be able to find a form like this nearby, which you can put your name on and some comments, helpful comments, evaluations for Santoria. The speaker is Brian Bonacola. I'm here to announce this project. This is Evaluator of My Head.
Good evening, fellow members, guests, and viewers at home. I'm very delighted to introduce you for the tonight's speech from Ryan Prana-Miller. The title of his speech is An Inspirational Musician in My Life. Ryan, if I have to describe him, I'll start with the music. Music is a universal language. Ryan Prana-Miller studied acoustic finger-picking guitar in college and has practiced songs from Rise Up Singing Folk Songbook. He is a current alumni from Iowa American Corps. He'll tell us about a musician who has been popular among college students, mainly millionaires. And his speech is from speech number 5, Advanced Storytelling. So I'd like to welcome
him.
And what's the project?
And the project is speech number 5, Advanced Storytelling.
Historical figure.
Historical figure.
Historical figure, that's
yes.
Okay.
Please welcome.
Thank you. Good evening, Toastmasters. It's great to be back. I've been gone for a couple weeks, finishing my AmeriCorps training, and I'm now here. Greetings, Toastmasters, fellow guests, I guess we've got a couple guests, and viewers at home. Music is the language of all cultures. It is a cross-cultural language. Anybody appreciates music. It is a universal language, kind of like smiling, laughing,
it's, I think we can all relate that music has a universal accepting, you know, we all have favorite musicians,
right?
Just think of your favorite musician and anybody want to tell me one of their favorite musicians? Michael Jackson, nice. All right, anybody else?
Peter Ben-Suzan.
Peter Ben-Suzan, okay.
Mick Jagger.
Mick Jagger.
Willie Nelson.
Willie Nelson. What was that one song?
Dave Grusin.
Dave who? Rubek?
Grusin.
Grusin, okay. Well, I've got some that I recognize and some that I don't, but has anybody heard of Dave Matthews Band?
Yep.
Dave Matthews Band.
Yep.
He isn't a historical figure, but he is a popular and maybe I would argue will be a historical figure someday if people in the future learn to appreciate his music as I have. Dave Matthews was born in South Africa, or in Johannesburg, Africa. And at the time, it was there was a lot of political upheaval. His parents were architects and physicists, or a physicist and an architect, his dad and his mom, respectively. And he was recruited for the military during the apartheid movement, and he said no thanks, and they all flew to America. So this was about 30 years ago. And so he moved to America and he started playing at the Miller Bar. And it's kind of appropriate because my last name is Miller, so whatever that's worth. The Miller Bar, and he played with musicians, very top-notch, popular musicians. And some of these musicians were included later in his band. So Dave Matthews Band officially is Dave Matthews, a guy named by the last name Moore, M-O-O-R-E, Leroy, L-E-O-L-E-R-O-I, and Stefan, and Beauregard, somebody else. There's five people in the band. So he started playing music in 1993, and his first album was Remember Two Things, and it's a really popular album. A lot of people started enjoying his music in 93, and he basically just exploded on the scene in 93. Everybody started knowing about Dave Matthews Band, and so it was, I never actually heard about him until maybe 2 years ago. And a personal story, a friend of mine, James, is kind of a competitive card player that I used to play cards with. When the tensions got high, we would play Dave Matthews music, and it would kind of calm the tensions. He's a jazz player. He plays world music and folk. So that's kind of a history of Dave Matthews. So he's a, like I said, folk, jazz, and history era world music. He has a lot of albums, probably 15 albums, and his most famous one is probably Remember Two Things, which has like Satellite and a lot of other famous songs on it. I'm not trying to like sell you on Dave Matthews and tell you you should listen to his music, but you should listen to his music because it's good, and he's a really popular guy among the jazz group. So let's see. His music started out in, like I said, 93, and in 2005 he released Stand Up. No, what was it called? Yeah, Stand Up. And then 2009, his bass player, who goes by the name of Stefan Leroy. He had an ATV accident, and he died 2 months later. And then they had a big album that they spent 2 years working on. And I guess it's meaningful to me because just the power of a life event, and it changed his direction in the music. The music took on a whole new quality, different lyrics, tone, everything was different. I guess when I started playing music, I was learning Spanish music, and then I started farming and getting back to Earth and started researching folk music. So, so a kind of a life event that, that happened with the ATV accident changed his music forever. And they made the album Grubrux and Big Whiskey and Grubrux. So I don't know where that name came from, but Big Whiskey and Grubrux was the album released in 2009, and it had, I guess it was a nickname actually for the bass player, which that he would go by. So this guy, Big Whiskey and Grubrux, like I said, he passed away, and then the music started kind of changing, but it's still very popular today. Like I said, he's not a historical figure yet, but if he, in the future, if he continues his music as it is, I think people will enjoy his music as much as I did. And he'll go down in the history books as one of the best jazz world music folk musicians in the world. So, Dave Matthews Band, check it out on YouTube. And one of my favorite songs, just to end it on, it's kind of in a personal speech, one of my favorite songs I would say by him is You and Me, which is kind of an inspirational song about, I guess, his wife and he, who they said they can do anything together and go anywhere together. And another song was You and Me and Too Much is another good song I recognize. Very great song. So check him out on YouTube. Thanks for listening.
Thank you, Ryan. Now, how's that? We can have 2 minutes on the clock again to write evaluation. I'd like to call upon our general evaluator, Will Burns, to run the evaluation.
Now this is the best part of Toastmasters, the part where we get feedback, where we get criticism, but mostly we also get uplifted and inspired. And to start us off on that path, our first evaluator, Jeff Shipley.
Thanks, Will. Fellow Toastmasters, it's great to be up here to hopefully uplift and inspire all of you, especially Santoria Rush. Evaluating a experienced speaker is a huge responsibility, often a challenge. So if the PR officer ever is paying attention, to take a picture to commemorate the occasion, that'd be appreciated. Easiest way for me to do this is just go by the manual. And so there's all these categories here. I was asked to rate things 1 to 5. I rated everything a 5. It was excellent, just because. So that was like speech value, preparation, organization, opening, body, conclusion, transitions. I mean, I don't really like the rating scale, whatever. It was a great speech, a lot of humor, people laughed. The first thing I have to mention, though, I do have some suggestions. I have to apologize. I completely botched the introduction. I stuttered over myself on the introduction. I messed up with the flow. I take full responsibility for that and the hesitation. But as you noticed, I came over, and you did seem a little hesitant at first, and so then that translated to me. Either way, you know, it's really got to be get up and go. I'm behind this podium. I'm in charge now. I'm running the show. And so just more of that, just showtime, ready to go, because I can't imagine any reason you would be nervous. I mean, when you get up here, you're perfectly comfortable. But I did notice that did translate into a little bit of a slow start. But as soon as you got comfortable and started going through your 3 points, you had some big laughs from the crowd. So you opened it very personally. You said zombies right off the bat, and then you said how this is personally important to you, which was, you know, captivating. It gets our attention. You're talking about you as a little girl, zombies, interesting topic. A lot of misdirection, and that was really the humor, was misdirection, because from the speech title itself, I thought you were going to be talking about something totally different. Zombie apocalypse. Okay. One thing I noticed would have been room for more audience participation. You kind of rattled off the facts behind the zombies. And again, that was more of the slower opening. It would have been better to, or in my opinion, would have been better. Hey, you know, what do you think of when you think of zombies? And get, you know, the audience to kind of shout things out, get them invested a little bit more in your talk. The biggest laugh you had was when you did the grunting noises, when you actually emulated the zombie yourself. You could incorporate that all throughout the speech. You could have been walking around here like you're a zombie saying, you know, give me a glass of water or whatever, you know, it was based on your punchline. Again, just an idea. Obviously, you have to be comfortable or it's not going to work, but that's just something. When you emulated the zombie, the audience reacted the best. So act out, use your body. The misdirection humor, I thought there was actually a lot more room for that. And I actually said one of my suggestions, coming from me, you can take this or leave it. I believe in insulting people, and zombies is really a great insult. You could call any group of people zombies, and it's kind of hilarious. Like, you know, the zombies walking in out of dome every day, or whatever. Or you said for some, you mentioned Black Friday. If there's anything about zombie hordes running, you know, Black Friday is epitome of that. You could have tied together that more. Am I past my time? Okay, well, then I'm going to keep going then because we're ahead of schedule in the meeting and I got more things to say. So,
They always clap me off too.
You carried on and on and on the last time this happened.
Jeff, always a pleasure. Looking forward to hearing more from you. And, you know, I didn't come up here to do it myself. I wanted to stay down there, but it's my duty here. I'm sorry.
I'm upset.
Just well, you know what? Part of life is being insulted. And now it's my pleasure to call up our next evaluator, Mahesh Gautam.
Fellow Toastmaster member, guests and viewers at home. To start his evaluation, I'll say the first line that he mentioned. Music is the language. When he said that, because I'm also a musician, I totally understand it. Because music is for sure a language. For example, there's a sad song, we have very slow music. If there's a rock and roll song, very fast music. If there's a metal song, a lot of music. So yeah, it made me clear. It totally gave me a picture of what is the music and how and what kind of what why it is a language. The main objective of this speech was build through climax. He needed to build by giving a climax. So he built the climax of a music. He said that music is a language of all through laughing and smiling. I understood this point, but I didn't exactly got on this point. He asked the audience by asking, what is your favorite musician? He asked everyone and gave the choices. And then he said about his favorite musician. He then introduced Dave Matthews. He said that he will be a historical figure. Then he prepared a speech of how he Dave Matthews going to be a historical figure. He gave an introduction on how he moved to America and started playing in Miller's Bar and how his name is so common, like his name is also Miller, that's also, yeah. He gave what kind of music he plays, and he gave, from what year he started playing music, from 1993, he gave his first albums, in which year, and how many number of albums he has been to date, and about the popularity of the jazz group. And he ended up his speech by saying about his favorite song, You and Me, and the other was Too Much. What I have to say, the speech is very well organized because it gave us a background, it gave us a clear picture, and it gives us a conclusion. It totally gave us a climax. It made a climax for everyone here. And he had a very good hand movement. He was moving his hand like this from here. For every explanation, he was moving his hand. And he had a really calm voice. when he said about the music, I do that. You need to be a musician. I want you to be a singer because you have a very calm voice. And then, if I have to say anything about his weakness, I'll say if anyone is saying something about the music, then it might be a little bit wise to bring some instruments or something, or play a little bit of fineness. This is what it's called as a the
player
in the music. This is what I like. From something like 10 seconds, 20 seconds, and most of the time he was a little bit here. If he was a little bit from a movement on the stage, it would have been much more better. And except that, I really enjoyed his speech, and I'm very glad to evaluate him today for his speech. And I'm for sure I'm gonna listen to Dave Matthews song today. Like.
And now let's move right into table topics. I want you to call up our table topics master, or our table topics mistress.
Master.
Jean Symington Craig.
In Hollywood, they don't call themselves actresses anymore. Everybody's an actor. It's kind of the melting pot thing. Table topics. We're going to change our brain muscles up a little bit. These are the impromptu speeches where you don't know what I'm going to ask you. But you have up to 30 seconds to think about how you might respond, and then answer the question. And Isaac will be timing, so after 1 minute, he'll turn on the green, and a minute and a half, it'll be yellow, and then at red, you want to be finishing up because you have 30 seconds to finish up after that. And by the way, this clapping off immediately, I don't really like either, but I...
You're talking to me now?
I'm the same. Because I set a bad example, because somehow the rules don't apply to me, and they do. So, that is it. Don't like it, but that's the way it is. Yes?
We've got that on video.
Yeah.
What? Did I? Okay. You want me to sign something? I'll sign something. Yes. Now, at home, it's a different story.
Yes.
Okay.
I'm volunteering.
Oh, you're volunteering. Okay, so let me just, I love eager beavers. Oh, this looks like I'm gonna challenge. Okay, all right. So we have the rules here. Okay, good. So we have a volunteer right up. Jeff, come on up.
I know
exactly how you feel. He chose to celebrate
my birthday.
This is his birthday today. On top of that, let's give him a hand. I don't know, maybe the rules don't apply on your birthday. Could we even say that, maybe? No, probably not. Can't do it. They're like, hurry up. Okay, they're ready. Okay. The theme for tonight is victory and peace. So all the questions are around victory and peace. Jeff, imagine that you are a dog. Please tell us what kind of dog you are and what would be a victorious day, how it would look to you from that perspective.
Thanks, Gene, for that remarkably easy question. If I was a dog, I'd be a wiener dog, and victory for me would be participating in the annual Oktoberfest wiener dog race and sprinting from the finish line, pounding my little heart and legs out for a full 10 meters, and then getting that blue ribbon at the end of the race with a jar of sauerkraut to celebrate. But I'm not a dog. I'm not a dog, maybe in a past life, maybe in a future life, but not this life.
I'm a lion. I'm a Leo. It's my birth month. I'm feeling very fierce and ferocious, especially when I'm wearing my wiener dog t-shirt. Also feeling very cute and cuddly, especially when I'm wearing my wiener dog t-shirt. And it's great. Yeah, so I think I answered that question. I had a dog, we actually mentioned this before the meeting. She was the third fastest wiener dog for her age division in the 2014 race. Yeah, there's three dogs competing, and she earned a remarkable yellow ribbon. And she's died since then. She moved on to the next life. I think she's probably a giraffe or something with an equally awkward body. And anyway, we put her face on a postcard now, and we send those out. So she has achieved immortality with help from me and my artistic design and moving the digital image onto the postcard, and then the United States Postal Service facilitating that. So it's really great. And again, that's victory is life after death for a dog because of your monumental performance in said wiener dogs race. So that's the gift I hope to share with all wiener dogs, whether or not I am an incarnation of one or not. But my shirt, I think this is probably my fifth day in a row wearing this. And this fashion trend is likely to persist. Thank you, Tabletop Master.
Of waffles is going for that
apple. And a broccoli. It's a similar face.
Thank you, Jeff, for that canine experience. All right, who wants to go up next? Rick Starr. In your opinion, what is a key element for achieving victory in life? How did you apply that element to a success or a victory in your life? Tell us the story.
Could you repeat that?
Okay. In your opinion, what is a key element for achieving victory in life? How did you apply that element to a success or a victory in your life? And tell us the story about that.
Madam Table Topics Master, Mr. Toastmaster, fellow Toastmasters, honored guests, viewers at home. My goal for Table Topics is always to make the greeting as long as possible. That condenses the time. I don't want to talk about my victory, but referring back to the previous question, I'll talk about my dog's victory. I once had a dog, a border collie. We called him, originally enough, Puppy. And Puppy was full of life, high-spirited, afraid of nothing. The only thing Puppy was afraid of was thunder. And we didn't know this until one day we left Puppy out in the backyard and there was a thunderstorm. No lightning or rain, just thunder. When we got home, we discovered the following. Puppy had broken through a glass cellar window.
Oh my.
Hurled himself onto the floor, raced up the stairs, and chewed through the door that led to the kitchen.
Wow.
When we came home, the house was a wreck, the cellar door was broken. Thanks God, Puppy had no cuts on him, no injuries, and he had chewed through the kitchen door. It cost me several hundred dollars to fix. This is one of the many, many wreckages Puppy had caused in our house, but it was a victory for Puppy. Puppy got from the terror of the thunder to the safety of the kitchen. Madam Table.
Woo!
Okay, stand back in front. That gentleman in the back? Yeah. Okay. Okay, that was just All righty.
Not make it difficult.
No, I'm just tailoring to the. Okay. Think about an historical figure that you admire who achieved a victory. What happened, and what was it about his or her victory that inspires you?
Yes, please.
Okay. Think of an historical figure that you admire who achieved a victory. What happened, and what was it about his or her victory that inspires you? You have up to 30 seconds to kind of think on that.
I'll
okay,
think
of
that.
Here we go.
Thank you.
Good evening, Toastmasters, Madame
Table
Topics. Table Topics Master, sorry. And viewers at home and guests. The question was about to think about somebody in history that make a victory that I could relate to. There are so many people that are victorious, but I cannot come out with one in this moment. I think about all those, right now that we are in the Olympics, I think about all those athletes that do an effort just to be there. They have to work out very hard since early in the mornings, and they do it only to be in the Olympics, maybe to get a medal. That is very, very difficult for me to just to wake up and go and run or go swim. It's incredible. But seeing them inspired me and other people to try and do our best in whatever we are doing. I try to work out harder, I try to study more, try to help more people every day, just because I can see that there is a way to victory through the effort. Thank you for the question.
Thank you for that. Okay, so I'm trying to come up with some thought-provoking questions. And I have a couple more. It's so nice to have a nice, that's a victory in and of itself. We have a new clock that works. You know, that's all you want of a clock is to work, and it works. So that's a simple victory, but feeling good. All right, who else wants to come up? All right, stand up. Okay, that's like, okay, just a little, there I am doing stuff again that I shouldn't be doing. Alrighty. Okay, let's see this one. When you're having a day or week that is challenging, where do you go, what do, or who do you go to in order to get some peace of mind?
Toastmasters, guests, and viewers at home. When myself and my husband get into simpatico discussions, Well, I end up with tears. And some most of the time it is, I'm defeated with the arguments that we have between myself and my husband. I think, I wouldn't think it to be a defeat to myself at that moment. It might be a defeat. But later when I think about the situation and the instance that went on and like why I gave up, it is just to calm down the situation at that moment. Don't want to extend that rough time. So it's better one person calms down and gives up. That is a victory in itself, I think. It might look a defeat to the other person, but to me, I think at that moment is a victory to bringing peace to that environment and making my family in peace. So there are many situations, especially when my kids and myself want to buy a puppy in my house, and my husband is still against having a puppy.
Oh, no.
So it's because he has his own reasons. But we have carpeted floor, and like it's during winter, and he thinks about all the points that would affect the family in a way, because my kids are allergic to many things, so that would in fact aggravate my kids' allergies. He does have valid points, but we are still trying to convince him to get a puppy soon. So hopefully we will get a victory having a puppy soon and have a peaceful, enjoyable life with our new puppy that we are hoping to have soon in our home. Thank you.
Has dogs here? Okay, do you have carpet in your house anywhere?
Yeah, stained carpet with holes in
it. You have the wrong dog. I need to call him. Okay, so there you go. All right, we have one more question. Let's see, am I good on that? Sudeep, was that a hand raising sort of, kind of? We do like to exercise in this class. I know we're not exactly jumping up and down, but one way we can exercise is when we want to volunteer for something is you shoot that hand up. And you feel those muscles engage. No, it's not like, yeah, like that. And then really on an advanced level, you alternate. So the next time you volunteer, you use the other arm.
Actually, I was not sure you're going to ask to come.
There was another one, so
yeah.
you were kind of a starting block, ready to like, okay, blow that whistle. All right, well just, we're all learning how to do this. Okay. Sudeep, tell us about a time in your life when you felt victorious. What was happening and what were you doing? Tell us about a time when you felt victorious. What was the situation? What was happening? And what did you do to get that feeling?
Sure. Dear fellow speakers, so today I'm going to tell about the moment when I felt victorious. It's really with my work. So I used to work in a contract with the Microsoft, and then I used to work with a team. So I always believe that your hard work, your constant dedication will pay off. And I really started with I didn't have much knowledge about the work they used to do, but I had set up this in my mind that I'm going to be hired by Microsoft someday. So that was my goal. And always I
dedicated my time and then be very honest about my work. That's continuous dedication. Some people, they come, they jump, rush everything, they try to show, but they don't last. But I had this constant commitment to my work. And then I remember a day when my manager called me and then said that I really want you to be in my team. You really make a value for our team. So I think that was the victorious moment for me, and then it paid off what I set my goal. Thank you.
Let's see, where are we? I'm almost there. Should I do one more, or are we? We're done?
Yeah.
All righty, Mr. Timer, would you please give us the names? You don't need to give the times, but just give the names of the people who qualified in table topics. No, just the table topics, just this section.
Everyone qualified.
Okay, and could you help us remember by reading the names?
The names are Jeff, Rick, Amanda, Sue,
Orlando. Okay, so Jeff, Rick, Andal, Orlando, Sudeep. So we have five. If you could just go ahead and vote. All right. Now it's time to call up our table topics evaluator. Dan, are you good with 2 to 3?
I have for 1 more minute.
Yep.
Okay. So 3 to 4. All right, good. Let's warmly welcome up our table topics evaluator.
Thank you, Madam Topics Master, fellow Toastmasters, honored guests, viewers at home. Our first table topic speaker tonight was Jeff Shipley. One suggestion for him is to greet the audience. One thing I particularly liked about Jeff's talk was that he segued. He didn't want to talk about sweet little puppy dogs. He wanted to say he was a lion. Good humor, and I liked hearing a little bit about waffles again. One more suggestion for you, I would like to see a little more eye contact. As you think, you tend to look down. Pretty good contact in between, but that does happen. Rick Starr, good greeting. As you told us, it was an overdone greeting while you thought in the other part of your brain. I like that you segued, because you had a great dog story, and a very good story. We all enjoyed it. I think my suggestion for you is a little vocal variety. Your storytelling was quite enjoyable, the volume level that you had, but I thought you could have maybe put a little more emotion into it. Maybe you could have said that Puppy was just almost a perfect dog, but we found out one day that there was something that really bothered Our next speaker is Orlando. So nice to see Orlando back, one of our former members. He's doing a cameo appearance, I guess. I like that Orlando remembered how to greet the audience. Way to go. All those Toastmaster lessons stick with you, I guess. My suggestion for you, Orlando, was that while you were kind of thinking what to say, you started out saying, I can't think of anything to say. And then you remembered the Olympics, and you had a very, very nice talk from that point, that they inspired you with their effort to get out and do what you needed to do and work out and so on. So good talk. Then we had Andal. She thought for a little while, which not many of our speakers did tonight. That's a good thing. She greeted the audience, again, very good. And then she gave an interesting talk about how a situation where it would seem on one level that you're being defeated can be understood as a victory if you think about it. In this case, it was a victory because giving up in the moment brought peace. I think my only suggestion for you is in regard to the vocal projection. Generally good, but you did have a tendency, in my opinion, to occasionally tail off your volume in your sentences, kind of swallow the ends. And finally, Sudeep, going quickly, I didn't need all this time. You greeted the audience, though I'm also going to give you a suggestion there. Whereas Rick gave us the 3-minute greeting, you gave us the 3-second greeting. It was like, hi, everyone. We could get a little more formal. But an interesting talk. It was, we learned a bit about you, how it is that you had a goal to be on the Microsoft team, and how you succeeded at that and felt that that was a victory. So that was a plus. And also another plus was that I felt you had a very nice, solid presence. Many of us, as we talk, kind of do this. And what I enjoyed seeing about your talk was that you were just relaxed and standing there solid. You might also think at times to move a little and stand again and move back, but very nice presence. I compliment you on that. And that is all for me, Mr. Jamola Riley.
Now we've heard from all of our evaluators tonight. So, Mr. Timer, could we hear the names of all of the evaluators, including Dan, who just spoke? Which one's qualified, please? No one qualified.
All right.
Well, that's easy. Actually, quick question. What's the time on Dan?
Dan's 4 minutes.
Okay, he's okay if he was within the, is it 42? All right. We're checking right now. We're checking the timing ballot.
Time
to begin.
Okay. So what? Okay.
No problem.
Dan qualified?
I think they both qualified.
Mr. Timer.
Yeah, Jeff.
I just want to
finish. And Craig, one of them.
Okay, please vote for Jeff,
okay.
Mahesh, or Dan. The reports, we'll start with our timer. Isaac, will you please give us the timer's report? Just tell us the times of everybody that spoke, please.
Ryan at 7 minutes and 19 seconds. At the table topics, we have Jeff at 1 minute and 51 seconds. Rick Starr at 1 minute and 65 seconds. Orlando, 1 minute and 43 seconds. Andal at 1 minute and 68 seconds. And Sugi at 1 minute and 6 seconds. And as an evaluation, we have Jeff at 3 minutes and 52 seconds. And Mahesh at 3 minutes and 7 seconds. And Dan Craig at 4 minutes.
I'd like to make an interjection. Can I make an interjection?
We'll hear from you at the end.
Okay.
Next, we have to hear from our grammarian, Will Burns. Thank you. Well, if I wore a hat, it would be off to Ephraim and Angal for using Simpatico tonight. If somebody else used it, just give a hand. It's a challenging word. I wasn't sure how I was going to use it. I don't think I used it yet, actually. But there's still time, hopefully. Some of the language I loved, starting with Santoria's speech. What would you do if a zombie approached you? That just hit me, I would, what would I do? Probably run. And that tied in nicely with her with a later point, where she reminded us the important statistic that 80% of people in zombie inhabited areas are all active runners, healthier people. Prana, I liked, you said music is universal, like smiling. Jeff, I liked how you were feeling fierce wearing your wiener dog shirt. You also saw. And that victory for a dog is life after death. Something we all need to think about. Our legacy. And next is here from our art counter, Ephraim.
Okay, I'll start with myself. I said one ah. Jeff Shipley, three us, one you know, one soul, and two end. Santoria, one butt, one end. Mahesh, one one soul, and one end. Ran, Prana Miller, three us, one soul, and five end. Arocha, one Andal Krishna, one The rest, thank you.
And now to provide a little levity and a little brevity with 1 minute, Arya Kitson.
So the English teacher is working with her classroom on sentence construction. She gives a few sample words, and the student has to construct a sentence using the words that she's given. So she has one very smart aleck student in the class, and he volunteers, she thinks. So she gives him the word defense, detail, deduct, and defeat. And he thinks for a bit, and his sentence is, defeat of deduct went over defense before detail.
That's not all.
Whoa.
The Department of Transportation in the state of Missouri has a program called Adopt a Highway. You may have seen it, it's here in Iowa also. Your private organization can volunteer to clean up and take care of a stretch of highway, and you get to post a sign for your organization promoting it. Our club could do that if we wanted. The State of Missouri Department of Transportation got an application that they wanted to reject. They turned it down. It was from the Ku Klux Klan. The Ku Klux Klan took them to court. The case ended up in the U.S. Supreme Court, which ruled against the Department of Transportation. On the basis of free speech, they couldn't deny the KKK the opportunity to have a sign posted and to take care of the highway and do a public service. The Department of Transportation snatched victory from the jaws of defeat. They just renamed the highway the Rosa Parks Freeway.
Yes.
Rosa Parks is an iconic figure in the American Civil Rights Movement.
Thank you, Art, for tying your jokes into the theme of the meeting. That's the person who actually does those themes. I really appreciate that. And now I will wear my hat. Yes, sir.
For the prepared speech, Rand also qualifies.
Okay. Too late. Thank you for the, you know, for the update. I've already voted. Closed. No recount. Okay. Moving on to other business.
Okay. I accept the fee.
Readers may.
general evaluator, my job to evaluate the evaluators. Jeff, I felt like you had good feedback for Santoria. My suggestion for you, you mentioned you had a pressing issue with the manual rating system within these manuals. I would have loved to have heard that. You said this 1-to-5 system wasn't working for you, and I want to know why. This is your chance to be up here on the soapbox, in front of the lectern. You could have done it. That's what I got for you. You can't change what you don't express. You can't defend or what you can't support. Mahesh, you captured a lot of the content of Prana's speech. And I should have a session for you, but unfortunately, I guess I forgot to note that. So my apologies, sir. Dan, I tell you, I had something to say about everybody's table topics. But I had a session for you, which I fortunately do. It's that you made a very good point about not being rooted. My suggestion was to be a little less rooted yourself. But I did like how you did move towards this table topic speaker when it was Mondal, for example, and you moved towards Sudeep. You got this beautiful space here. Use it. And now it's my pleasure to call up our Toastmaster once again, Art Atkinson, to present the meeting awards.
I must confess to be somewhat in the dark about the meeting awards tonight. We had one qualifying speaker, so we can celebrate the fact that we have a winner there. Is there a photographer in the house?
Yes.
Wait.
Hold it.
That's it.
3, 2, 1.
Got it.
Sorry, Ned.
What project was that? Number two.
So here you go. Wait.
And there is a no. Yes, there is a ribbon here for you. Organize your speech and ribbon, which you also received. This evaluator seems to be some controversy. My favorite candidate was apparently eliminated, but we do have one definite qualifying evaluator. So Mahesh.
All right.
Thank you. And now, a drum roll, please, for the best table topic speaker.
Say one thing, preferably good, about Toastmasters.
I like the evaluation which has come up. Hopefully for the next time when I come here, I'd like to get some feedback from you guys.
Good.
So I like how everyone was involved, that it was clear and it was, the audience was with the speakers, so yeah.
Thank you. I guess you're a guest. You can say one thing.
I love being here. This is very fun.
Before we have our induction ceremony for our new members, just a couple of comments I'd like to make about the meeting. Congratulations to Art, who presided over a somewhat chaotic meeting but managed to hold it together. Good job. One thing I'd like the Toastmaster to do, Will mentioned that he spends a lot of time getting these quotes. I'd like the Toastmaster to mention the theme and the quote associated with the meeting.
Yep.
So if we could remember to do that. Reminder, if you're speaking, please send the title of your speech to the VP of E and your evaluator. We had some people do that this week, some people didn't. We sort of kidded around about the time of the evaluation, but it's important in Toastmasters. We speak to a certain time, and we give evaluations to a certain time for the main purpose of speaking within a time box, within a certain time period. Because if we go on to speak, if we're a public speaker, usually you're not given 10 or 15 minutes, you're usually given a specific time slot. So that's good to learn. Table topics, Jean did a good job of balancing people who had spoken or hadn't spoken. One suggestion is maybe to work a guest in there along with the members. Will, I thought your evaluation of the speakers were a little light, and only one comments per each, so I'd like to see a little more full-featured evaluation. The evaluators, I mean, I'd like to see a little more full-featured. But I think the best statistics, 60% of our table topics had to do with dogs. I think that's a laudable goal and one that we've achieved. Yeah.
Yes. Could I ask about something we could do?
Yes.
Because it seems like everyone's using the members, you know, a member 7515 at Toastmaster, you know that. And if when you send out the matrix, you know, where I think Rick was doing this before, at the front, if you put Ryan Cronemiller, your evaluator is and put the email address of the evaluator, then the speaker and the evaluator don't have to get the whole club, you know, we don't have all those emails going back and forth, because really it's just the speakers that need to communicate with the evaluators and vice versa. And then also, Will, you could put your email address in, because that's the other thing, and then people can send the title to Will, as opposed to everybody hearing the titles all ahead of time and stuff like that. You get that? And then as the officers, I can't do it because I'm not in the officer thing, but we periodically send out an updated version of the directory, and so you can email people without emailing the whole club, and sometimes that would be useful. So I don't know if we can get one of those.
Good, I'll send one. Or Will, why don't you send one? Send out a member list.
Yeah.
I think we have one.
They're always sort of changing, so right. You have to keep sending out the latest.
You have Google Docs, which updates every time you add one, every they have access to it. Easy.
Well, it's a Toastmaster, you know, synced deal.
Right. Oh, really? Okay.
But the thing is, it's just to you evaluators and speakers can work offline, and VP of Ed work offline with him and everybody else like that. Okay, that's what I said.
Good. Any more business? We'd like to induct our new members. So, Mr. Sergeant of Arms, could you escort three new members out of the room, please? That's Ephraim, Sudeep, and Isaac.
Yep, come on, guys.
Okay.
You want guests to stay?
Guests can leave if they'd like.
Or can they stay if they want?
They can stay if they want. So yes, of course, the three new members are Efren Tewelde, Isaac Kablamichael, and Sudeep Pradhan. Does anyone have anything to say, either for or against these new members? Jean.
Yeah, I'm impressed with how they are engaging and stepping up and seem to have the right attitude. So I think they are going to be great members.
Good. I agree. Anyone else have any comments?
I would second her opinion.
Okay. Would anyone like to make a motion to approve these three new members?
I so move.
Second.
What's the motion?
I vote that we approve Isaac, Ephraim, and Sadiq as new members.
Okay, second back there?
Second the motion. Too.
All in favor of approving these three new members, say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, say nay.
Nay.
Nay. No, sorry.
All opposed, say nay. In the chair's opinion, ayes have it. Could you ask them to come in, please?
Pardon me.
Yeah. Okay. One in. Okay.
Just come up here, stand here. Sudeep, Ephraim, and Isaac, as members of the Fairfield Goldman Speakers Toastmasters Club, you will benefit from a proven program of self-development. Toastmasters is a worldwide organization dedicated to helping one another in a spirit of sharing and enjoyment. Please affirm your commitment to the Fairfield Goldman Speakers by answering, I will, after I read all these statements. Do you promise to attend club meetings regularly, to prepare all speech and leadership projects to the best of your ability, basing them on projects and the competent communication or advanced manuals, to prepare for and fulfill meeting assignments, to provide fellow members with helpful constructive evaluations, to help the club maintain the positive, friendly environment necessary for all members to learn and grow, to serve the club as an officer when called upon to do so, treat your fellow club members and guests with respect and courtesy, to bring guests to club meetings so they can see the benefits Toastmasters membership offers, to adhere to the guidelines and rules for all Toastmasters education and recognition programs, and to maintain honest and high ethical standards during the conduct of all Toastmasters activities. Thank you. Members, please stand. We, the members of Goldman Speakers Toastmasters, pledge to support you in your quest for self-development, to provide you with positive, helpful evaluations, to maintain a friendly, supportive atmosphere, to give you opportunities to help others, and to make your Toastmasters membership a rewarding and fulfilling experience.
We do.
Thank you. Fellow Toastmasters, welcome our new members. So thank you all for coming. Thank you for participating. I declare the meeting adjourned.
Oh, thank you.